let's take this statement and act on it with a del z bar and a delta. Okay, the second two. So del z bar of t z z of z is del w bar of t z z w is equal to c by 2 del z bar del w bar 1 over z minus w bar. You definitely set this to 0. But you must be careful because that z equals w is a singularity. So you must be careful to scale 0 when z is not w. Z equals w, you have to be careful. So let's keep those things around. And we're worried about singularities at considered points. Okay, now the next step, we say that from energy conservation, from diffeomorphism invariance of the regional theory, this thing is the same as del z of tz, zz bar. And this thing is the same as del z, z, t, z, z, z bar, w. Delta. Hello. No, not yet. I'll call you later. Okay. And then we take the delta to delta w out. Okay, so what we get now is some statement about how the two-point function, some derivatives of the two-point function of z, zz bar, and zz bar behave. Okay, now we take the statement and integrate it once with respect to z and with respect to w. That integral will reduce this z minus w to the 4 to z minus w to the 2, and you'll pick up some factors. Okay? So what you have then is some statement which schematically, keeping track of no factors, is schematically tzz bar of z, that's tzz bar of w, is like del z bar del w bar 1 over z minus w, the whole thing squared. Okay, now 1 over z minus w, the whole thing squared, it can be thought of as del z del w of log of z minus w. Again, we track no factors. Differentiating twice. Okay, so what this is del square m. Up to factors, del square with respect to z, then del square with respect to w of log of z minus w. Now you see why it would have been so dangerous to just say this was 0. Because del square of log of z minus w is not 0, it's a delta function. Anyway. We actually want to put a mod square here. That's fine, that statement would remain true. Okay, so this thing is schematically like del omega squared of a delta function, which is precisely what we wanted to show. With some factors that you have to get right. So what I hope I've convinced you of, what I would like you to carefully work out for next class, including all factors, okay, is that tzz bar z times tzz bar w in flat space cannot be thought of as, tzz bar can't be thought of as precisely the zero. It's something that has zero expectation value. Okay? But its two-point function has non-zero contact terms. These non-zero contact terms are completely determined by what we know about the theory. And in fact, it's given by this. Okay? Which then implies that the one-point function of the trace of the stress tensor in a background that is not flat, but a little bit curved, is non-zero. Okay? I'd like you to, okay, I'm not going to say more about this thing now. Go and think about it at home, and we come back and talk about it more next class. Okay. I have one more exercise I want you guys to try, which again, you go and think about it at home. And, yeah, please.
Okay, this is just, it's like an anomaly thing.
Yes, it's exactly.
So this is a corresponding thing to how we calculate the anomaly, that's like...
Yeah,
if you just proceeded in a standard QFT way, regulated and remove the regulator,
yeah,
we get this.
You would, in fact, it's polia of, it does this calculation, this work, somewhere, roughly that way. It's a little subtle though, for the following reason, that you must define T mu mu correctly. You see, you must define T mu mu as the response of the partition function to a change in conformance. Because if you thought of, if you wanted to ask, what is, you might have first been puzzled, how can I possibly do this calculation in the standard way of doing things? Because I don't have an operator to insert. Suppose we're working with the free boson theory, for instance. The classical operator corresponding to T mu mu is zero. It's just zero by equations proportion. Okay? Since it's not, as you say, it's an anomaly, and it's all in the measure in some sense. So, if you did it all correctly using standard quantity, then you will get it, but you have to do it carefully. This is a much easier way to do things, because it's very easy using usual techniques to get control of what T is doing. But then once you know everything about what T is doing, by different orbits and invariants, you know everything about what TZZ passed. That's the basic point. Right? I know the code, the two-point functions of TZZ. Therefore, I know everything about the two-point functions of TZZ.
Since we use the energy conservation,
yes.
Is this some kind of a statement that if it was not so with the energy conservation?
Exactly. It's possible to set this this two-point function to zero exactly. But then you will violate the proposal. It's the usual statement with anomalies. You regulate the theory in order to preserve some things, you must give up others. But you often have the choice about what to give up.
But energy conservation means expectation value of just the divergence of that operator.
Right.
Energy conservation would not be violated if the
we don't want just that. We want the whole quad
operator. Quad identity.
Yeah, basically, in order to derive this result, all we have used is the statement that we can replace this expectation value by this one.
Inside the code.
Okay? If that were not true, that statement were modified, you could modify that statement in a way to set this thing to zero. Okay? But this statement follows from some requirement. The requirement essentially that diffeomorphism invariants of the theory be a good symmetry. Okay, and that we are going to treat as sacrosanct. It's the usual statement. It's like when you have a global and gate symmetry. You often run into a situation with anomalies where you are able to keep the global symmetry non-anomalous at the expense of making the gate symmetry. And you never take that option because the theory of the gate symmetry anomalous is inconsistent. Same kind of thing here. The two-point function of T trace with itself is zero, it's not zero. But okay, so what? But the theory was not. If you want the T invariant, it would be very one, especially in string theory. It's totally inconsistent. Okay? Fine. So go through this exercise, convince yourself of the logic being used here, and work on all the concepts. That's the first exercise. The second exercise, maybe I should just talk about the last exercise. Okay, maybe it's important. It's important now. I'll just talk about it in class. Okay, so just go through this, and then next time in class we'll finish up our general discussion of conformality theories, and then turn to a discussion specific. Okay, that's it. Okay, next time in class we will also find that we will, in a very related but similar but in a slightly more conceptually interesting way, we will find the same result. We'll also talk about, you know, how, you see, this was only step one of that exercise. You know, we found the trace of the stress tensor. We'll also talk about how the whole partition function of the theory is completely determined from the statement in terms of the central charge. Yeah, well, I should talk about it in class. Okay, so that's it. Let's put the camera off. That's the discussion you want to have.